a long weekend in May, and it's raining, as is our tradition in Canada. And I'm sure that some people will come back with fish stories. I have some fish stories. I'm really bad at fishing for fish, the fish that live in the water. I'm not super successful. I have a few fish stories, and I can tell you about the ones that got away, but what's the point in that? They may even, and over time, the ones that got away gradually increase in size. Looks like I was, you know, going after Moby Dick with 8-pound test, but that's not true. They just, I don't have any pictures to verify the ones that got away. It's a little frustrating. This morning, we're going to be talking about an amazing fish story. And as many of you know, we've been going through the stained glass windows of our church here at Elim Chapel, admiring some of the artwork. Next week, spoiler alert, next week is going to be a lot of fun. It's going to be action-packed because the children are going to be with us in the service. And immediately, some of you start to panic, thinking, wait a minute, what about the sermon? Doesn't matter if I ever listen to it or especially apply it, I just need a sermon. There will be 6 mini-sermons preached around the sanctuary. And I hope you participate fully and engage. I like Jan's announcement because this thing about intergenerational stuff is very biblical and we can learn from each other. We can learn from children and children can learn from us. So, next Sunday is going to be a little bit abbreviated because we're trying to respect the attention span of a younger child, which really isn't that much longer than the attention span of an average adult, although we don't want to admit it. And we're going to experience these pictures together. But today, the picture I want to talk about is right back there. So I'm going to ask you to indulge me for a minute. Stand up and turn around and look at that back window. It's going to be a lot easier on your neck and your back. See? Okay. Jesus is talking to 2 potential disciples. It's kind of like an ecclesiastical recruiting poster. Okay? That's what it's all about. Okay, now you can sit down. That's the one. And I just wanted you, it's much nicer to look at the real thing than an image in PowerPoint. I mean, you're welcome to do that if you want. Anyway, this is the story that was read this morning from Mark. Matthew also contains a similar story, and it looks like, at first glance, you read the story and you're thinking, bam, these guys left right away, like the first time they ever met Jesus. That's not exactly the way it happened. And when you put the Gospels together carefully and put them in kind of chronological order, you realize that Matthew and Mark had kind of the abbreviated version. And Jesus was preaching in that area for quite a period of time, and he had some ongoing conversations with Peter and his brother Andrew and James and his brother John. So there was this ongoing relationship building, and they were listening to his preaching. And he had invited them a couple of times before, you guys should be following me. And they were thinking about it and mulling over, and I think from the passage that I'm going to read you, this is Dr. Luke's version of what happened. He packs a few more details in it, and he packs in a whale of a story, pun intended, of a miraculous catch of fish that I think you'll find just fascinating. I know I do. So, let's see if we can find it here. Aha. So this is from Luke chapter 5, okay? One day, as Jesus was walking along the shore of the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon, that was Peter's old name before he started following Jesus, Simon and his brother Andrew throwing a net into the water, for they fished for a living. Jesus called out to them, come follow me and I'll show you how to fish for people, okay? So that's what we saw before. Oh, where did that come from? Oh, I'll tell you later, that one. This is the Luke version. One day as Jesus was preaching on the shore of the Sea of Galilee, great crowds pressed in on him to listen to the word of God. He noticed two empty boats at the water's edge, for the fishermen had left them and were washing their nets. Okay? So, here's the deal. Jesus is preaching. He'd often preach on the beach, basically, on the Sea of Galilee. And I think for a couple of reasons, a couple of practical reasons, there's such a big crowd who's literally getting almost pushed into the water anyway. And the natural acoustics of the lake. You know how you can hear across the lake how the sound travels so much better? I think Jesus was taking advantage of that as well. So, there were a couple of empty boats. Peter and Andrew and James and John had been fishing, and they had their boats up on the shore. They were washing their nets. They had been working the night shift, and they were cleaning up before they went home. Stepping into one of the boats, Jesus asked Simon, it was Peter, his owner, to push it out into the water. I think they had this ongoing relationship. It wasn't just a spontaneous, hey, I just met you, can I borrow your boat? I can show you through putting the Gospels together that this had been an ongoing relationship. So Peter says, yeah, sure, I mean, I'm not using it anyway. I'm cleaning up, I'm going home. So go ahead, borrow the boat. Jesus sat in the boat, which was smart. We're taught not to stand up in a canoe, right? Don't stand up in the boat. He sat down. That's also what rabbis did in his day. They would sit down to teach. And I think, kind of like we have a signal here before the service starts at about 20 after 10, when Ken sits down on the organ, then all the other sound stops, and it's kind of the signal, right, for Ken to play the organ before about 10 minutes before the service starts. In the same way, when Jesus sat down to teach, that was a signal for the crowd to settle down and go, shh, Rabbi's going to talk. Okay. So they kind of settled down so they could hear him. So Jesus sat in the boat. He taught the crowds from there. Now, you might think that's kind of weird to sit in a boat and be talking to the people on the beach. But again, when you think about the natural acoustics of the water, it made a lot of sense. Plus, it was so busy, they were so hemmed in, that he could effectively communicate with people. So he's teaching them. What is he teaching them? About the kingdom of God. He's saying, these are God's values. All these pictures here that we've been talking about, they're all about the kingdom of God. Right? All about the Creator communicating with His creation. Hey, I want to be one of you. Hey, I want to be in relationship with you. And all about these, remember we've been talking a little bit about these upside down values? The foolishness of God is greater than the wisdom of men. The weakness of God is greater than the strength of men. It's an upside down kingdom. If you're going to follow Jesus, if you're going to join His kingdom, you're going to have to learn how to look at life upside down. I'm not suggesting you go home and stand in your head. When the blood rushes to my head, bad things happen. Okay, so I'm not suggesting that. But it's an upside down way because God's priorities are not ours, right? God is not impressed with us showing off our human achievements, especially as a way to get approval from Him. It doesn't work. You can try it. You can try it. You can try to be religious. You can try to look good. You can try to polish up that image. All I can say is, been there, done that, got several t-shirts. Good luck with that. Eventually, you'll get tired of that and want the real thing. Okay? I'm not down on organized religion. It's kind of ironic for a pastor to say that. But what I'm very skeptical about is our self-efforts to prove ourselves to God. To say, hey, I'm good enough. Or say to one another, hey, look at me. Aren't I something? And those things happen. Now, most of us would never admit to being like that. But they can be so subtle. It's so easy for us in our society, just in human nature, to get into performance-based religion. You know, performance-based faith. Have I prayed enough? Have I tithed enough? And the treasurer is saying, no, tithe more. Have I loved enough? Have I done enough? Our relationship with God is based on His tenacious love for us. And when I say tenacious, he looks for us until he finds us. That's God's love. All right? So, Jesus is teaching the crowds about the kingdom of God and what God is really like. And that's why there were crowds. People were dying to hear this. Because all they had experienced before, especially from the Pharisees, was performance-based religion. Do this, do that, and look good. The Pharisees kept all or most of the rules, but they took all their identity from rule-keeping, and they didn't even know the rule-maker. You understand? They got so caught up in the details, they missed the forest for the trees. And that's why Jesus attracted these crowds. And when he was done speaking, he said to Simon, "All right, now, go out where it's deeper, and let down your nets to catch some fish." Now, let's take a minute to unpack this statement. This is morning, probably mid-morning, okay? What are the guys doing? What are Peter and his friends doing when Jesus comes along and starts this little lecture series from the boat? What are they doing? They're cleaning their nets. They've been fishing all night. You fish at night when it's cooler, when the fish are closer to the surface and easier to catch. So they've been working all night, and now they're cleaning their nets, which is a lousy job. Lousy job. Because you've got stuff stuck in the nets, and you got to clean them, and they're all slimy. And if you don't clean them properly, if you dry them, they're going to be so rigid, you won't be able to use them. One of the most important things I learned when working in the trades is when you're done work, you've got to stop and clean your tools before you start work the next day. If you're making concrete or making cement or something, you've got to get all those shovels cleaned off. Otherwise, what are you going to get? The next day, your shovel's going to be at least a pound heavier. And if you don't clean it the next day, it's going to be another pound heavier. And if you don't clean it the next day, please, student, it's time to get a new shovel, right? Which is pretty dumb. I mean, if you're just the Joe Blow flunky guy in the bottom like I was, you know, the gopher coffee, gopher this, the gopher, then you don't really care. But if you're the business owner, you don't want to be buying a new shovel every week. So you clean your tool. It's a really important part of the trade. That's what the fishermen were doing. They were cleaning their nets. It's kind of an arduous, lousy process. And spoiler alert, these guys had a frustrating night because they hadn't caught anything. You see this in the myth and story. So imagine how Peter's feeling. He's really tired, been up all night, totally frustrated. This fishing hole is no good. It's all fished out. These are professional fishermen. They know where the fish are because they make their living by catching fish and knowing where the fish are, right? And then they sell their catch on the beach the next day. They probably, with all these crowds of people, it would have been really embarrassing for Peter and his buddies, the professional fishermen, to say, we struck out. Everyone's asking, even out of curiosity, when you see a fisherman, say, "Hey, are they biting? You know, are you catching anything?" Now the people coming expecting, "Hey, let's go have some fresh fish for breakfast or lunch or whatever. Let's go. Have you got anything today? What do you got?" Nothing. "What? What do you mean nothing?" And then people think all these, you know, shaming thoughts of, "Peter, you guys are terrible fishermen. Why would I ever come back here?" So all these things are going on. Peter, he's personally frustrated. He's thinking, he's looking foolish in front of all these other people, and potential customers are walking away from him. He's not really in a good frame of mind. And here comes Jesus. Peter's finally cleaned up all their nets. They're going to pack it in, go home and sleep, and try again. They're going to have to go home to their families and say, "No luck today." And I'm sure there'll be a few discussions about the household budget when they get home, but nothing to show for it. A little bit of tension to anticipate there. Then along comes this carpenter who probably knows nothing about fish. And he says, "Hey, Pete, go get some fish." shallows, go way out into the middle of the lake. The Sea of Galilee is about 150 feet deep. It's about 10 kilometers by 20 kilometers. So it's a big lake. So you got to work hard, get way out there in the deep. Let down your nets to catch some fish. Now you're Peter. What are you going to think? No way. You are crazy. What does a carpenter know about fishing, right? And I'm sorry, you're out of your area of expertise. You're nuts. Forget it. And I don't know if this actually happened or not. Probably not. I like this cartoon. He says, you idiot. He said, cast the nets. Cast the nets. Anyway, if you like bad puns, you'll get along fine with me. Anyway, master. Now, Peter's respectful, okay? He's his master, because they have a relationship. And Peter trusted Jesus enough with his boat, you know, to borrow it while they were cleaning up before they went to get home. All right? So they had a relationship. So Peter's being respectful, but he says, Master, we worked hard all last night. We weren't loafing. We weren't out there just sort of puttering around and listening to the stereo all night and just with our feet up and not actively trying to catch fish. We worked hard all night. And if you haven't noticed, it's the middle of the morning and we like to go home to sleep. Thank you very much. And we didn't catch a thing. We struck out. We bombed. But if you say so, I'll let the nets down again. Now, why did Peter do that? I'm curious. Now, the gospel writers don't really tell us what tone of voice that was in or what Peter's attitude was. But I wonder a little bit if he was being a little bit passive-aggressive. Well, I'll show you. What a dumb idea this is. We just cleaned up. We're just getting ready to go home and pack it in. And you want us to go out there again and get our nets all dirty and go over it all again and lose all the sleep because you think you know better than us pros. You think you know better than the people who do it. You know, I mean, we know fish. My dad fished. My grandfather fished. We know fish. And you think you know better. Huh? All right. We'll do it. So they did. They did. And this time, their nets were so full of fish that the nets began to tear. Can you imagine? Can you imagine the tension, the weight on those nets? How many fish must have been there. The nets begin to tear. It's amazing. So they shout for help, and James and John go out with the other boat. And soon both boats are filled with fish and on the verge of sinking. Now it takes a lot to sink a boat. Imagine they're pulling it in, and the gunwales are just above the waves, and they're worried about swamping and sinking. Can you imagine? How would you feel? Yeah, I would feel scared, yeah, and excited, and thinking, this is unbelievable. I can't believe it. This doesn't happen. We were just here, and there's nothing here. We thought this place was all fished out. When Simon Peter realized what had happened, so they get to the shore with all this bounty of fish. When Simon Peter realized what had happened, he fell to his knees before Jesus and said, Oh, Lord, please leave. I'm too much of a sinner to be around you. For he was awestruck by the number of fish they had caught. As were the others with him, his partners James and John, the sons of Zebedee, were also amazed. Now, why would Peter say this? I mean, I would, you know, once you drag your boats to shore and you're filled with this bumper crop of fish, I mean, it would set you up for who knows how long, but what a harvest. And the first thing you say is, oh, Jesus, you got to leave. I can't handle being around you. Man, I would be hugging him and saying, what, you know, pick up your favorite filet, you know, we'll have the shore lunch right here. Thank you so much. But the first thing Peter says is, Lord, leave me. I'm too much of a sinner to be around you. Why does Peter say that?
he realizes that he's, pun intended, he's out of his depth with Jesus, right? He is out of his depth. He, the professional fisherman, was trying to tell Jesus that he knew better. And Jesus demonstrates that he's the creator. Look, I made the fish, dude. So I know where the fish are. You go up there and the fish will go into the net. Just do what I say. And Peter, as full of skepticism as he was willing to take that step of faith and follow Jesus. Follow his instruction and obey him. Now, a lot of us, even though we're skeptical and not sure of Jesus, if we can trust him or not, even if we have that little bit of faith, we still obey and Jesus comes through. That's what Jesus was trying to teach Peter. But Peter's response, he was so humbled by what had happened. He was so humbled by his previously skeptical, bad attitude. He realized, oh, I can't believe that I just told the Messiah to take on a living. I can't believe this. So Lord, you've got to go. I just can't be around you. He was just struck and convicted by his own unworthiness to be around Jesus. He was awestruck. And all the other professional fishermen there were awestruck too. Jesus is something to Simon, which is just kind of totally reassuring. When we come to Jesus, when we're broken, when we realize how much we've messed up, how we need him, and we say, oh man, I don't even deserve to be in your family. I don't deserve to be around you. I've messed up so much, God. I've messed up so much. What does Jesus say to us? Yeah, don't be afraid. He says, don't be afraid. Fear not, right? And then he gives Peter a new job description. From now on, you'll be fishing for people. And as soon as they landed, they left everything and followed Jesus. There's something fascinating about this story. All the three stories that we've been talking about have a link. And this is one of the links, I think, all about the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God is all about God using unlikely people and unlikely circumstances. This is a photo of a poster that's down in the youth room. The youth room, if you haven't been down there recently, is the coolest part of this building. And I don't know why Pastor Justina gets to have all the fun. It's really not fair. But they have this poster up on the wall, and I got a picture of it, and I'm going to read you what it says in case you can't see it. Do you seriously think God can use you? And it lists some of the characters in biblical history that were unlikely people that were used by God in his kingdom. Noah was a drunk. Abraham was too old. Isaac was a daydreamer. Jacob was a liar. Leah had a prettier sister. Joseph was abused. Moses had a stuttering problem. He had a speech impediment. Gideon was afraid. Samson had long hair and was a womanizer. Rahab was a prostitute. Jeremiah and Timothy were too young. David had an affair and was a murderer. Elijah was suicidal. Isaiah preached naked. Jonah ran from God. Naomi was a widow. Job went bankrupt. Peter denied Christ. The disciples fell asleep while praying. The Samaritan woman was divorced. Zacchaeus was too small. Paul was too religious. Timothy had an ulcer. And Lazarus was dead. Well, we're in good company, aren't we? Aren't we? Anybody here feel unqualified to be in God's family? Anybody here feel unqualified to be used by God? Remember, dear brothers and sisters, that few of you were wise in the world's eyes or powerful or wealthy when God called you. Instead, God chose things the world considers foolish in order to shame those who think they're wise. And he chose things that are powerless to shame those who are powerful. God chose things despised by the world, things counted as nothing at all, and used them to bring to nothing what the world considers important. As a result, no one can ever boast in the presence of God. First window, God uses a baby to change the world history. Very simple peasant folk, very unlikely beginnings. Middle window over there, there's a 12-year-old kid teaching the theologians of the day what God's message is really all about. And then, in the window we're talking about today, Jesus astounds the professional fishermen, people in their area of expertise, and saying, you know what? I know best. If you follow me, I will show you what I can do. God chooses unlikely people to accomplish his work. Why? Because I think God likes to show his glory and power through unlikely people. That's the way he chooses to do things. And that's why I love this story so much. Jesus had to teach Peter in his own language. He taught him the language of fish. I'm the boss. I'm the creator. A couple of weeks ago, I had a fascinating conversation at a camp I was at with a PhD student in physics from China. And you know what has really convinced him that there is a God? He studied Isaac Newton. If you know anything about Isaac Newton, he's really core to the values of physics. And Newton believed in a creator. And this young man, bright, I mean, here's Rick and here's the student where I'm talking about physics, but he was absolutely convinced that there was a creator and God had revealed himself to this young man through the natural world, through the study of physics. And he was speaking his language. Just like Jesus was speaking Peter's language through the miraculous provision of all these fish. And this physics student is learning about God through studying this rising man. It's fascinating. Jesus will meet us where we're at in a language we can understand. He will connect with us. And he will personally call us to follow him. This may or may not mean leaving your day job. Peter and the disciples were a little bit different because Jesus needed to spend more time with them and so on. But Jesus invites us to follow him. And he will do whatever it takes to come after us and lovingly invite us to follow him. He's not trying to fish us in that sense. He's not trying to put a hook in us and pull. When Jesus goes fishing for people, he used nets of love and invitation, not coercion or power. That's what sets him apart from the rest of the world, the rest of society, because Jesus doesn't dominate or manipulate or force people to follow him, but he will woo us. He will draw us to him. How many of us are following Jesus, not out of a sense of duty or compulsion, but like, he loves me so much. He knows everything about me, yet still loves me. And he loves me enough that he doesn't want me to stay like that, but he's offering to help transform me into who he's called me to be. It's irresistible. When you think about it, it's irresistible. And who can say no to that kind of a relationship? And God in his wisdom chooses things that are despised by the world. Things counted as nothing at all. Little babies, 12-year-old kids, carpenters who don't know anything about fish. He uses all those things to demonstrate that God's foolishness is greater than man's wisdom. God's weakness is greater than man's power. Why? To demonstrate that self-sufficient people won't be happy in the kingdom of God. Self-important, self-sufficient, prideful people won't be at home in the kingdom of God. Keep in mind there's a difference between being proud and having self-respect. Okay, you understand that? All right? But a proud, prideful person is full of themselves, literally. You won't be happy in the kingdom of God. And you wouldn't be happy in heaven, so don't even think about going there, all right? It's just my advice as some kind of spiritual travel agent. You won't be happy there because there's God there. And he's bigger than you, right? And there won't be room for both of you. But once we get rid of our pride, and that's what happened to Peter. He was humbled by what happened. He was the expert in this story, right? Okay, if you say so, whatever, we'll go fishing. And what happens? He's stunned. And he comes and realizes, wow, Jesus, you're not just a religious teacher. You are God. Nobody can pull this off. And he's humbled. And then Jesus said, don't be afraid. Follow me. That's Jesus' invitation to us today. Drop the pride. Leave the self-sufficiency behind. All right? And follow Jesus. That's a story we're tracking all through the windows. And the finale is next week. So let's pray. Jesus, I want to thank you that you delight in using the unlikely things of this world and unlikely people. Thank you that you do not call the qualified, but that you qualify the called. And thank you that you are calling us today to follow you. So we gladly come with all our weaknesses, challenges, disabilities, whatever they are, all of our challenges, we come to you and say, Lord, your grace is enough. It's all about you and not about us. Lord, take us out of here with a sense of your purpose and your calling in our lives. In Jesus' name.